Okay, so in the last class we were talking about power and energy. There was one small topic regarding the energy delay product at the end, which I'm going to just cover in one of the tutorial questions, only discussing now in class. What we are going to do today is take up a couple of different topics which don't really fit in with the direct flow that we have been following so far, but are important topics to sort of understand. Okay, so I'll be discussing both of them in not too much detail, but at least enough to sort of cover the basic ideas before we move on to the next major topic, which is sequential elements. So the first topic is with regard to scaling. Okay, so we know that circuits have been scaling in size for the past 30 years or so, right, or more than that even, right? Essentially, there are concepts such as Moore's law, which tell you that the number of transistors that are fitting on a given die are doubling in number every so many months, every 18 months or so, right? So that in turn has some impact on the speed, the power dissipation and various other factors of the circuit. So there are a couple of different models which talk about how we can think about the scaling of the circuit and what impact it has on these other parameters. Okay? So the first model is the so-called full scaling. Also known as constant electric field scaling. Also known as Dennard scaling, after the person who first proposed this model. Right? The idea as far as this particular model of scaling is concerned is, we say that in a given circuit, all the parameters, both the voltages as well as dimensions, scale by the same factor. We call that factor S. Okay? So what this means is that W goes as 1 over S. Okay? L goes as 1 over S. So these are the two obvious dimensions that we have in our control. And what we are saying is both of those dimensions go down by a factor of S. Okay? Typically, from one generation to the next, this factor S is how much? So far, we discussed this somewhere earlier in the class, right? By how much does W or the L typically scale from one generation to the next in CMOS technology? Somebody speak up loudly. Okay, so it's usually the most common factor is root 2. Right? So around, if you have a length of 1 micron in one generation, the next generation is typically 0.7 micron. Why is that? So that the area as such, which is the product of W into L, comes down by a factor of half. Okay? So this S, the most common factor that we are going to encounter as we go from one generation to the next is S equal to root 2. Right? S equal to root 2, so 1 over S, which is the scaling factor on W and L, is 1 over root 2. Okay? But the scaling model itself doesn't necessarily talk about how much is the scaling which is used. It just says if there is a scaling, then what you are doing is you are scaling the dimensions by a certain factor. You also scale all voltages. Right? Both the VDD and the V threshold, and correspondingly also the VD sat and so on, come down by a factor of butane 1 over it. Okay. The VDD is in your control. You can bring it down by a factor of 1 over it. The V threshold is also controlled by you. Okay. Now, why is this called constant electric field scaling? Obvious reason. The voltage has come down by a factor of 1 over it. The lengths have also come down by a factor of 1 over it. So, the electric field is going to remain constant. Okay. So, now let's just see what is the impact of this on other parameters of the circuit. The first one is the C of what happens to this? Assuming that all dimensions, not just W and L, are coming down by a factor 1 over it. This will go up by a factor of it. Okay? But the actual C gate, which is the complete gate capacitance, this is given by C of into WL. So what happens to this? This goes as 1 over it. Okay, so in other words, the gate capacitance for a given transistor, right, the minimum size transistor, so to say, is going to be scaling down by a factor of 1 over it. Okay. What about the factor K? Mu C of into W by L. What about mu? Is there going to be an effect of scaling? Mu is a technology parameter, right? It depends on the substrate. So, as such, directly there is not going to be any effect on the mobility. The C of, we have just found out, goes up by a factor of L. Right? And W by L, W and L both go by the same factor, 1 over L. So, they cancel out. So, this overall goes up by a factor of L. Right? What about the saturation current, the on current? What happens to the on current? One by L. Why? Because you have the mu C of W by L. Okay? And you have the V dS into VGS minus VT minus VDS by 2. Okay? So both of those terms are scaling by 1 over L. The Kn term, the mu C of W by L, is going up by S. The other two terms are going down by 1 over S. So overall we have a reduction in the maximum current. Okay, so as we go from one generation to the next, the peak current, the saturation current, is reducing. Okay? What does that say about the on resistance? What happens to the on resistance? It stays the same, right? This is not exactly VDD by ISR, but it's proportional to VDD by ISR. So it remains constant. It is proportional to 1, so to say, right? Not to 1 over S or to S. Okay? So what does this mean for the intrinsic delay? What is intrinsic delay? RC. R on is constant, C is the total C gate, not the C per unit area. Total C gate as gone as 1 over s. So intrinsic delay goes as 1 over s. Okay? What about power consumption? Power consumption is given by V into I. Right? Voltage 1 over S. I charge also 1 over S. So this goes as 1 over S square. Okay? This is the total power consumed in the circuit for a given set of transistors. Right? But what that means is that the power density is power per unit area. What happens to the area? It of course goes down by 1 over s square. Right? So power has gone down by 1 over s square, area has gone down by 1 over s square. It remains constant. Okay? So this is yet another term which is used in order to refer to this kind of scaling, which is constant power density. Right? So how did it become constant power density? What we said was all our dimensions have gone down by a factor of 1 over s. The voltages have also come down by the same factor. Okay? And that was important. The fact that the voltages came down is what led to reduction in the power, which meant that the power density remained constant. Okay? So this was one model of scaling which was very popular for many years. The problem with it is the voltages. Right? It's not really possible for the voltages to continue scaling. Why? What happens if you reduce your voltages more and more? Your noise margins reduce. And secondly, what happens to subthreshold current? What happens if you reduce VGD without reducing VTA? If you reduce VGD without reducing VTS, your currents are reducing. If you reduce VTS, what happens? Your subthreshold currents start increasing. Okay? So the amount of leakage and hence the wasted current becomes more and more significant if we try doing this kind of constant electric field scale. Okay? So the next model, which also applies for a lot of and for which is also considered a valid model for many of these generations of logic, is to say fixed voltage scale. So here, for example, what we have is the W and L continue going as 1 over S, but the voltages are constant. Okay? The one indicates that it is not scaling with generation. Okay? Now this is increasingly similar to what we actually see in practice, because effectively what we found was up to around, you know, voltages did scale 3.3 volts, 2.5 volts, 1.8 volts, even down to 1.2 volts. But below that, you see that it sort of saturates. It then goes to 1.1 volts, 1 volt. That's about it. You don't really go below 1 volt significantly. Okay? So it more or less saturates over there. The voltages remain constant at around 1 volt or so. So what happens in such a situation? Let's look at the same parameters once again. Area of course goes as 1 over s square. The C of etc. remains the same. because those are only related to the dimension. What does change is eyesight. Right? In this case, the eyesight is actually given by 3 of into W into V. Right? Under velocity saturation condition. Okay? So this pretty much remains a constant. Okay. It's not just the mu T of into W by L, you can't just use that formula directly. What happens is, this part of it, I mean this particular equation we did not look at in detail in the class, but the current under velocity saturation pretty much goes as proportional to T of into W into V. Okay. T of and W, their effects offset each other, V remains a constant. So, the I sat, the maximum current as we go from one generation to the next, saturates and becomes pretty much a constant. Okay? Now, what that means is that the current, the R on, what happens to this? V is constant, I is constant, R on also becomes constant. Okay? The C gate has reduced as before. So the intrinsic delay this goes as 1 over it. It reduces. It continues to reduce. Okay? Power consumption, total power, V and I sat both are constant, so total power remains constant, which means the power density it now goes up by a factor of S square. So this is a much more problematic scenario in some sense, because what it's telling you is that the power density, the power per unit area, is increasing quite sharply, doubling with every generation. Okay? How do you deal with such high power densities after a while? Because once you go along this for a few generations, it means that the power densities are going to be very significant. Okay? In fact, if you look at presentations from a few years back, you will see many of them talking about how the power density on the Intel Pentium chips of that era were already at the level of that of an electric hot plate used for cooking. Okay? And that within a few more years, it would have soon gone up towards the levels of a rocket nozzle, and eventually they were extrapolating to the surface of the sun. Okay? Now obviously that's unrealistic. You don't want to have a nuclear reactor sitting on your desktop. Right? But the point was, it couldn't be allowed to continue. Okay? So, the constant electric field scaling no longer held. Fixed voltage scaling was a better model, but on the other hand had the serious problem that the power density was going up very sharply. Okay? What was done in practice was some kind of a generalized scaling. This is a combination of both, where the voltages were considered to scale by another factor, U, right, and the dimensions by a factor S. So that effectively, now you can go back and work out once again over here what happens to each of these things, but the problem is now it just becomes a combination of U and S. Right? And depending on how much is the scaling factor on U, you could either have increasing power densities or you could have the power density is kept under control. Okay. The reality is of course some kind of a mix of both. But the dimensions scale by some factor. The voltages are not kept exactly constant. They also scale, but not by the same factor as the dimensions. Okay. The other question which we are not going to go into over here is, how is the problem of the nuclear reactor solved? Right? How is it that we don't have complete meltdown of circuits happening nowadays? This is actually quite an interesting problem. The only way of solving it is to say, okay, we'll actually reduce the amount of active silicon, the amount of switching that is happening at any given point in time. Okay? And nowadays, if you go look at the literature that is currently becoming more popular in conferences and so on, and in fact there are some special workshops being conducted just on this topic, there is a concept of something called dark silicon. What do you think dark silicon is? Effectively what we are saying is it is not dissipating power. Okay? So what does that mean? Why would you ever put silicon over there? Why would you put a circuit which is not dissipating power? It's not that it's not dissipating power, it's not that you are just putting useless circuitry over there. It is not quite exactly a heat sink. It is more that different parts of the circuit are kept active at different times. Okay? So at any given point in time, can you guess how much of a circuit is actually active, in the sense that how much of it is switching? Is it 100%, is it 50%, is it smaller than that? What do you think would the numbers be like now? 100% of a circuit switching means basically that all of it is active, right? So something useful is being done in all parts of the circuit. Let's say that you are building a microprocessor. Every single part of the circuit is doing something useful. And ideally that's what we would like to imagine, right? The pipelining after all means something of that sort. Some part of the processor is fetching instructions, some other part is decoding the previous instruction, some other part is executing yet another instruction. So ideally all parts of the circuit should be kept busy at the same time. In practice, that's not the case. What needs to end up happening is significant parts of the circuit are kept idle. They are not all active at the same time. Okay? And typically the activity factors would be less than 10% or so. At any given point in time, you would find that less than 10% or even much less than that nowadays is actually active at a given point in time. Okay? So a large part of the circuit is dark, that is to say not switching, nothing is happening to it at a given point in time. Okay. So how do you sort of compensate for this? Various other techniques such as having multiple cores, having multiple things that are active at different times, you balance out the activity across the different parts of the circuit so that the instantaneous power becomes controlled. Okay. All right. So that is just one small digression with regard to scaling. The next topic that I'm going to take up is related to the main project that you will also be starting very soon. Okay. Which is essentially what you are required to do is design completely some gate. Okay, what do I mean by design completely? Design at the transistor level, go down to the magic layout level, extract the transistor level circuit from magic, do the simulations and characterize the delays and power dissipation of a particular gate. Okay, what kind of gate? I'll be giving you the list of choices that you have, and essentially each of you working in some groups of maybe 3 or 4 are to complete the entire project work. So, in order to understand how exactly these things are done, or at least one particular method that is used in order to design circuits, there is a concept of so-called standard cell. the idea behind standard cells is, in order to create a large circuit, you are going to build it up out of small gates, right? A large number of small gates. How do you build those gates and how do you sort of place them and connect them up together in such a way that they function correctly, so that the complexity is kept under control? What that means is the number of gates that are going to be there in a typical modern circuit could easily be in the region of the millions. Okay, you have millions of gates in one reasonably complex modern circuit. Okay. So if all of those million gates have to be designed by hand, designed individually, that just becomes too much work, even for a large team of engineers. So instead, what is done is to say, we'll standardize something. What we'll do is, we'll say that this is the overall chip. I'm going to break that chip up into segments and say that within each one, each of these blocks over here is going to be a single gate. Okay. Now the important part of this is all gates now have the same height. And what we do is, this upper layer over here, I'm going to put one long wire over here and connect VDD to it. Put another long wire down here. And connect ground. And put in some restrictions. Basically say that for every gate, this is VDD, this is ground. The input and the output are along the side. Now, if you are lucky, what that means is that you might be able to directly take the output of one gate and connect it to the input of the next gate. But even if that is not so perfectly aligned, all that it means is you need a small piece of metal connecting the output of one gate to the input of the next gate, provided they are at least in the same row. And if they are not in the same row, then what it means is you need to somehow figure out how to go to the row where it is. So you need to have some metal wire which takes you across from one row to another, and over there go horizontally to the correct place. Okay. So the routing of connection happens on metal layer. And the number of metal layers, the more the number of metal layers that you have, the better the chance that you will be able to route all your signals properly without running into problems. Okay? So, what has this achieved? Essentially what it allows us to do is, it standardizes certain things as far as the design is concerned. It tells us that all the cells or all the gates that are used inside a circuit have some fixed property. They have the same height. On top they have VDD, on bottom they have ground. Their inputs and outputs are on the left and right respectively. And there will also probably be some restrictions such as on which layer of metal the inputs and outputs are supposed to be placed. And by means of that you can connect them up properly so that they form the required connections and the functionality that whatever you need is achieved properly. Okay. So this kind of standard cell structure is commonly used. The advantage of using this is that one time I need to design these standard cells, right, and characterize them. So what does characterizing the cells mean? It means that you effectively find out the voltage transfer characteristics, that's one, but that's probably secondary. More important is the delay characteristics. How much is the delay through a cell for different types of input? Okay. And typically what is done over here is that the inputs are characterized for a large number of different output load values. Okay. And also for a large number of input slew. So what we say is, let's say that we have an inverter. We have CL, the load. And we have some input RAM. Okay. So there is some speed at which the input is changing. It turns out that the delay is a function of CL as well as input slew. Okay. It's not a function of CL alone. Of course, so far we characterized it, when we did the calculations and we did the logical effort computations and so on, we assumed it was only related to the load capacitance. In reality, it is also related to the input slew. Okay. So what is the characterization ends up doing is to create some kind of a table. Choose many different load capacitances. Choose many different input slews. And under these conditions, we essentially say what is the delay through the gate if I have a given capacitance as the load and a given input slew. Okay. What is input slew? It is basically the rate at which the input is changing, the volts per second. Right? The delta V, the amount of time that we have, the amount of voltage that there is a change over here, divided by the amount of time that we have. So once you have this kind of a two-dimensional lookup table, what you can say is, for any given value of input slew and given load capacitance, I will find out by interpolating within this table, what should be the actual value of the delay by doing a two-dimensional interpolation. Okay. I'm going to assume that my table is sufficiently well characterized that for all the different values that I have, it's able to cover the different choices of delay. Right? So if I get some value of slew and load capacitance which is not in the table, I can just interpolate between those values and find out the actual delay. Okay? So the process of characterizing a standard cell involves creating this table. You try out different values of the input slew, different values of load capacitance, And under those conditions, fill in these values in the lookup table. And once you have this value entered over here, it means that when you are actually doing the physical design, you can find out the actual delay through each gate by means of looking up these numbers. Okay? This is what the synthesis tools do, Synopsys Design Compiler and so on. Right? They have access to these tables. So what they do is they say that when you are connecting up the gates in a certain way, this is going to be the actual delay through the gate, and therefore this is the how much is the actual delay that you are going to see in practice. Okay? So what is the idea of standard cells? The idea of standard cells is rather than just having arbitrarily designed cells, which you can also use but it's going to be more difficult, you fix some of the things, such as the height of the cell, the locations of the inputs and outputs and so on, and characterize it. Once it has been characterized, the design tools can take over from there and say, okay, now I want to use a NAND gate. What are the available NAND gates? There are some multiple types of NAND gates available in my library, cell library. Okay? What are the different types of NAND gates? They will have different values of delays for input, different input slews and different load capacitance. Okay? Typically it's referred to as the so-called X1, X2, X4, etc. Right? So you have something called an inverter X1. That is defined as the inverter with a drive strength of 1. That is to say, whatever you consider as your unit load, that inverter is capable of driving that unit load. It need not be the same as a minimum size inverter. Okay? So one thing you will find when you go through this process of designing the standard cells is that the so-called minimum size inverter is no longer meaningful or useful. Because you have fixed the size, right? You fixed the height of the cell. Now within the constraint of that height, you would like to make the inverter as large as possible, or rather at least the transistors as large as possible, so that they can deliver a larger current for driving a larger load. Okay? So there is no benefit as such from designing the inverter to have the minimum transistor sizes possible. So because of that, what you will find is, in a standard cell design, typically a so-called inverter X1, that is the unit inverter, is not a minimum size inverter. It will have the same ratio of WP to WN as what is used in the minimum size inverter, but it won't have the same sizes. Okay? Scaling them up will result in larger inverters that may or may not take additional area. It depends on how much area is available to you within that same standard cell height. Okay? Alright, so this is the basic idea of how standard cells work. The next assignment, the major assignment, is going to be taking up different elements from a standard cell structure and doing the complete layout as well as extraction and characterization of the standard cell. Okay? Alright. So with that, we'll move on to the next topic. Which is sequential logic. Okay. So far we have talked about so-called combinational gate. Right? An example of a combinational gate is an inverter. It has a certain input VI and a output VO. This VO is directly a function of VI alone. Right? Depending on the value of VI, I can just go to the voltage transfer characteristic and tell you exactly what is going to be the value of VO. Right? It depends on nothing else. Now, that is a property of all combinational circuits. They depend only on their input. Okay. But very often in digital circuits, especially once you get to the area of finite state machines and actual useful circuits, what you find is you need to have some concept of memory in the system. Right? So in other words, I would like to have a gate whose output is a function both of the input as well as some other parameter which is an internal parameter of that gate. We will call it the internal state of the system. Okay? So this is the crucial part. I want to be able to have some kind of a gate whose output depends not just on its input but also on some other parameter which we will define as the state of the system. Okay? And that state is not something which depends purely on the input. It depends on the past history. Okay. Now what this allows you to do is that those elements which have that dependence on a previous state effectively have a memory. They are able to retain some kind of information about the previous state of the system even if the inputs are changed. Okay. So in other words, if I take an inverter and I just make the input floating, I don't connect anything to it, what can I say about the output? What will the output be? Huh? For an inverter. For an inverter, there is no concept of earlier state. Right? At best, if you are lucky, at the output of the inverter, there will be some capacitance. And whatever is there at that capacitance, whatever voltage is there at that capacitance will be the voltage that you see. But there is no guarantee of that. Depending on what your leakage current is like, depending on how much time has passed since you last observed the inverter, depending on whether some other voltage nearby fluctuated, this voltage can change. There is nothing which is holding the output of that inverter to a given value. Okay. Whereas for a sequential element, we want it to retain its output state irrespective of what happens to the input. Okay. So under certain conditions, even if I take away the input, it should be possible to say, okay, this is the present output of the system. It does not any longer depend on what the input is. There has to be some way of turning this entire gate into a state where it no longer depends on the input. Okay? And even without providing any input, the output is a stable logic value. Okay? So that is the important point. This ability to store some kind of an internal state is what differentiates a sequential element from a combinational one. Okay? And in our case, what we have is what are the typical examples that you know of from a basic course in digital circuits? The idea of the sequential element is it must have some kind of a controlling signal which we will call either the clock or the gate. Once again, that word gate. Unfortunately, we use that word gate for too many different things in this subject, right? But it's called the gating signal sometimes. The clock signal is probably more popular. Input, output. Okay? So there has to be some way by which that output can be a function of the present input and the previous state of the system. Okay? And also, of the clock signal itself, but we usually don't write it this way. We don't usually say that it's explicitly a function of the clock. The clock serves a different purpose. It doesn't determine what the output is going to be, it only determines when the output can change. So there are a few different terms that are commonly used for these kind of things. One of them is flip-flop, another one is latch, another is register. Okay. All of these relate to our different kinds of sequential elements. What we'll do is, we'll go into a little bit more detail on how each of them are defined in terms of functionality, right? And also look at many different ways by which you can actually implement the different kinds of sequential elements, realize them in practice. Okay? So we'll stop here for now, and tomorrow we'll continue with more detailed definitions of these kind of sequential elements.